Colorful apartment kitchen littered with paintings and houseplants. Winnie stands in front of an easel, a paint palette in hand. She adds dabs of color to the painting of a small red prayer candle that burns with a full flame. Her girlfriend, Theo, enters and places the mail on the kitchen table on top of a large pile of papers.
Hey.
Winnie sets down her palette and greets Theo with a hug.
You made it home. How was work?
Well, I didn't have any customers complain about steaming hot soup being too cold today, so all in all, it could have been worse.
Well, yeah, someday you won't have to work that day job anymore. Are you planning on working on your manuscript tonight?
Yeah, if I can get anywhere with it.
I thought we could spend some time together.
You know, you've been so busy with the gallery and this serving job is sucking the life out of me. I miss you.
Sure, but maybe it could be a working evening too. You know, we could work together because I miss you too. But I really need to finish my painting for my collection. I mean, I don't want to waste my time.
Okay, dear. I understand. But as soon as you get that last brush of paint on the canvas, I'm stealing you and taking you to bed.
Well, I don't know. It might be really late. I'm sorry, but I really want this painting to be a masterpiece.
Of course you do. And I would too if I were you. You're allowed to take breaks. Not everything you do has to be perfect.
Theo is cut off by the ringing of Winnie's cell phone. Winnie answers it.
Hello?
Winnie's brother Caleb is on the other line.
Hey, Winnie. We have some bad news. Mom is in the hospital.
What? What happened?
I was at home visiting because Dad said Mom had been feeling really sluggish lately and having a lot of respiratory issues. She just thought her fall allergies were kicking up or something. You know how she is, refusing to slow down, never going to the doctor even if she's really sick. He thought I could convince her to go in, but when I got there this morning, she ended up fainting. So I called an ambulance and they took her in and ran a bunch of tests and, well, Winnie, she has lung cancer and it's in the end stages. They don't think she has very long. Would you want to come to the hospital? Could you?
I don't know.
Look, Winnie, I know you two have had your differences, and I know you haven't talked to her in a long time, but she's our mom, and this might be the last time.
Winnie hangs up the phone abruptly and stands in the kitchen in a state of shock.
Who was that? Is everything okay?
It was Caleb. It's my mom. She's in the hospital. Terminal lung cancer. I mean, she's been sick for a while, I guess, but she didn't want to go in. That sounds like her, doesn't it?
Are you going to see her? Do you want to see her?
Not really, but it's like Caleb said, I mean, it's the last time I'll ever talk to her.
I'll look at the car.
2 years earlier, Winnie lights a candle and kneels by her bed.
Dear God, you know that lovely stomach-turning sensation when your mom calls you to tell you congratulations on your gallery space. She's sure it took a lot of time and effort for an art project. And could you bring a veggie dish to this year's Easter because she hopes you've learned enough responsibility by now to move on from bringing the plastic silverware? Oh, and when you say, sure, Mom, I can, I'm 26 years old and I do run my own business. She just laughs dismissively on the other end of the line, tells me that she doesn't mean to offend, but I've never been prompt or prepared for any of my family gatherings before. And so she just wants me to be thinking ahead. I mean, who says that to their own daughter? Oh, and she's just so sweet about it. So if I get angry, then I'm the one overreacting. I'm always the bad guy. I mean, I don't think I can think of a single thing she likes about me. If there is something she's never told me. She's my mom, but I think she hates me, and I think I hate her too.
Sue sits in a rocking chair, holding her own prayer candle.
Lord, I come to you in prayer. My heart has been so heavy this week. I've been burdened by having to worry that Patrick won't understand that we need lilacs and not hydrangeas in the back. Bless Caleb and his business ventures, and help him find a wife who will make him happy and who will give him the family he deserves. Because you and I both know that Winnie will never have given me any grandchildren. Speaking of Winnie, where do I begin? A strong little daughter. Oh Lord, help her to realize that her family cares for her and knows her true spirit. Help her to realize that art is a hobby, not a career. Help her understand that the sin that she is living in Theo. And finally, bring her back to you, O Lord. She is a lost sheep in the wilderness, but I know that you would leave the 99 for her. Thank you for your unending grace. Amen.
Winnie kneels by her bed again with a lit candle.
Dear God, apparently Theo is not welcome at the family Easter this year because my mom would be embarrassed for the volunteer ladies to see what a lesbian I'm turning into! As if I haven't been a lesbian all these years, even before I found a serious girlfriend. But being gay is only a sin if you act on it. Well, whatever. You know, maybe she could see why if she ever took the time to get to know Theo. To see how kind she is. How patient she is with me. How driven she is with her work. How talented of a writer she is. Because I believe in people's capacity to love. And I believe that matters more than anything superficial. Okay, so Theo's a woman. At least I have a healthy and happy relationship. At least my life doesn't look like her and Dad.
Sue, Bible in hand, lights a candle, sits in a chair, begins to pray.
Lord, I come to you in prayer. I don't know what to do. Winnie called me today to tell me that she wouldn't be coming in Easter if Theo wasn't also allowed to come. And then she told me that she was never coming to any family events or to speak to me at all until we agreed to give Theo a chance. And I just don't understand why she's pushing me away like this. Pushing you away like this. I raised her to do what was right and to obey her conscience. Follow the Bible, and instead she throws it all back in my face. The temptation of the devil has caused her to push her family away like this. Why would she forsake anything she knows for an improper relationship with someone that we all thought was a friend all this time? Oh, God, please bring her back to me. Please help her to understand that what she has done is wrong. Please help her to understand that I know her and that I will care for her. I care no matter what. Despite this blatant rebellion. Please prompt her to call me and apologize. Please, God, she's my daughter. Help me be the light that she needs to find her way out of this dark.
Winnie enters a hospital chapel with scuffed wooden pews, old carpet, and a small altar that is dusty and neglected. In the corner there are votive candles. Winnie walks up to one and lights it. She kneels on the kneeler and begins to pray.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Please, God, if you're even there, watch over my mother right now. I know it may be difficult for you, but please don't send her to hell. I mean, she might seem like a good candidate, believe me. I know. But then we would have to interact once I'm sent there, and neither of us have quite been bad enough for that. And you know, she just loves you so much. She'll be quick to tell anyone that. So when you bring her up to heaven, Lord, make sure she has the most spotless, neatly decorated eternal home. Give her all the things she's always wanted here on earth. Perfect luncheons and friends who feel obligated to compliment her because she made the most delicious quiche they've ever had. actually makes her happy. Because we both know I've never done that. God, why am I even here? Because I feel obligated to be, because Caleb asked me to come, because any good daughter would be here when their mom is dying. I wish I could be here just because of how much I love my mom, because of how close we are, because this truly devastates me, and instead I'm here and I just feel so, so angry, God, that I don't get to grieve my mother because she was kind and supportive and open, and because in a way, she already died to me 2 years ago when I stopped talking to her. I always thought that one day, you know, we would be able to patch things up. And we would be able to understand each other, and instead, she's on her deathbed. And I still don't know if she's ever actually loved me, or if all I've ever been is the family disappointment. Because if that's it, why am I still sad? Why am I not ready to lose her yet? Why can't I just?
Caleb wanted me to tell you that your mom's been awake for a bit. She's doing well enough to talk to you. I guess she really wants to see you.
Winnie and Theo cross to Sue's hospital room. Caleb sits calmly in a chair behind a facade of indifference and rises when the other two enter. Sue lies on the bed with labored breathing. Her hands rest on a well-worn Bible.
You want me to get the nurse while I'm out, Mom?
Always do, my dear. My pain meds are starting to wear off.
Caleb nods, placating. All exit but Winnie and Sue. Winnie sits next to Sue's bed and clasps her hands together tightly.
You understand your perception about why I don't talk to you anymore, but you don't understand the actual reason that I have for the decisions I've made, and you've never tried.
But God, sees the truth, and the truth is that you don't believe anymore. You've lost your faith, and so you are against your family, against me.
Just because my faith doesn't look the same as yours doesn't mean I don't believe. Just because my life looks different means I'm against the family.
Life doesn't reflect an open heart or a willing spirit.
Whatever that means. Look, Mom, this may very well be the last time that we ever talk and we're still just fighting. I mean, I never remember a day we weren't fighting. Can't you see the good that's come from this? Anything good in me?
Of course I can, Winnie. You're my daughter. I carried you for 9 months. You have my eyes and my nose. We used to bake together when you were little, do you remember? You always wanted to try your own way of mixing the dough together. Oh, we're very much alike. I used to be just as stubborn as you are now. You went ahead and opened that gallery, even though everyone told you not to. You know, I hear about your art on Facebook sometimes. Oh, what a nice hobby that turned out to be.
Right. A hobby. I mean, you were never able to view it as anything other than a hobby, even though I make my entire goddamn living off of it now.
Winnie, I just worried about
about you. I worried that you would never be able to make your way in the world. Art is not a stable career. It has never been a stable career for anyone. You've never been practical enough to see that one day you might have to have a backup plan. You were sure that you were going to be great. And it was my job to humble you a bit. And be ready to catch you when you fall. And remind you of reality. Well,
so it wasn't to support me. To love me, to tell me to pursue my dreams like every other cookie cutter 2.5 kid family in our neighborhood.
Well, to be honest, life's not perfect. You don't always get everything you want. I wasn't going to lie to you by telling you that.
I'm perfectly well acquainted with not getting what I want. I wanted a mom who supported me, who wouldn't judge me if my life turned out different from her expectations. I certainly did not get that. I know you don't give a shit about my art, and I know you never have, and I know you probably won't understand this either, but can I show you a piece that I've been working on?
How could you say that? I don't care about your art. I bought you art supplies as a kid. I've always been excited to see your talent grow. I just wanted you to be wise in how you used it.
Winnie pulls up photos on her phone to show her mother. The audience sees a set of three paintings on another area of the stage. The first painting depicts a young girl painting by a bright, full candlelight. The second painting depicts the girl's mother blowing the candle out and ashes scattering on her painting. The final painting depicts a burning candle sitting on the table of Winnie's current apartment with an easel in the background and Theo-like figure writing on the couch.
Remember the night in high school where I had just started my first surrealist landscape? The first piece that I painted that made me feel like I could be something, and I was so excited and I was working late into the night. I lit a candle and was experimenting, painting in dim light. And you came in and you started yelling at me about how we had church in the morning and how I would be shaming you in front of everyone if I fell asleep in the pews. When I tried to explain how important it was, how I had to get it all onto the canvas, how there would be other Sunday mornings, you blew that candle out and slammed the door on your way out. Now, I tried to have a conversation with you, and you left me standing there in the dark.
I don't remember that. Winnie, what a small thing to get so worked up about. I mean, you finished the painting.
Yes! That's not the point. You didn't care about my creativity or my process. You ignored what was most important to me because you worried about what your friends at church would think of us. And I finally found someone who does care, and you won't even let them be a part of our family.
Because it's not right, Winnie. I'm sure Theo is a very sweet girl. But I can't support a relationship that God and it was extremely upsetting that you would put her ahead of the people who raised you.
I chose my partner over my family. Yes, I made a choice. But you made a choice too, Mom. You chose your interpretation of a Bible verse over your own kid. It didn't matter to me that you didn't approve of the nature of my relationship. Really. But I mean, I never expected you. I had hoped that you would take a chance on something you didn't understand and get to know her instead of shutting her out and trying to pretend like a very important and real part of my life didn't exist. So yes, I made a choice. But I would never have been forced to choose between you and her if you hadn't created that dichotomy yourself.
What a dishonest view. I asked you to give your family some time for a few holidays. I didn't want that kind of sin underneath my roof. I didn't want to actively support it. It was my house, and I wanted to uphold my morals, and I asked you to come along for those reasons. But
I wanted to see you, Winnie. And you pushed me away.
No, Mom, you wanted to see the parts of me that you liked. The parts that were acceptable to you. Whenever I've been around, you've asked me to hide whatever it was that you didn't approve of. I guess at first it was my loudness. I was a wild, strong-willed kid, and you told me to sit still, behave myself, learn to stand up straight, stop getting dirty playing outside. Everybody called me a tomboy, like it was something cute at the time, but with the subtle hint that I needed to grow out of it. So I did. I mean, I let you sign me up for art and music lessons. You wanted an accomplished, feminine daughter, someone you could parade in front of your friends and say, look at her, she can play Beethoven sonatas and paint like the next Rembrandt. But as soon as I realized what an outlet art was and what I could use it for, my teacher started telling me I had real talent. You shunned it.
I never shunned it.
You always put my work down. You told me to try harder, told me I would never make something of myself with my canvases. You hated that I developed my own style. That I didn't just want to paint pretty landscapes or still lifes. You hated that I had a voice because of it. So I painted by night where I didn't have to listen to your criticisms. Then when I realized I was queer, you would never understand it. In the same way you didn't understand that real faith was for doubts. That if you think you are certain about who God is.
I am certain of who God is.
Oh, sure, you are. Your certainty has made you so close-minded. So I hid who I was from you. Don't tell me that you wanted to see me.
When?
Let me finish. You may have wanted to have me around at holidays so you could pretend for a little while that we were a happy, stable family so that everyone else thought we were good and helpful and involved and you raised your kids right. And I'm sure you thoroughly liked the version of me you invented in your head. The one where you hoped I would see the light, start living the right way again. But you have never actually seen me. Mom, you're laying here and you're dying and you don't even know me. You've never known me. You've never understood me. You never cared about me. Can't you see how much it hurt me? How much I wanted you to like me? And now you're dying and you'll never have the time to get to know who I really am. All I wanted you to understand is that just because I'm queer and an artist and made my faith something different than yours doesn't mean I'm not worthy of your respect.
That world. And still you embraced it. embrace the ideals of this new culture that says it doesn't matter who you love as long as you're happy. You made every possible misstep, and I loved you through all of them. I wanted a relationship with you in spite of your flaws. I tried to call you every week. I told you what you needed to hear, that Theo and your art, they would never truly fulfill you. And your sinful nature hated me for that. Hated me that I always told the truth. All I wish is that I had prayed harder. Prayed so much that your hard heart could no longer withstand the strength of my intercession. Don't you dare say that I didn't care about you, Winifred. You are my daughter. You will always be my daughter, and I will always be your mother, who loves you and wants the best for you. Even after I'm gone.
No. I thought for a moment, just maybe you might understand why I thought you didn't care. No. I'm done, Mom. I'm done trying to make you see me. I'm done trying to make you respect me. They think they love me, but you will never know what it truly means to love.
The finality of this statement leaves Sue looking shocked. At that moment, her breathing becomes even more labored than it has been. Winnie stands up and presses the button to call for the nurse. She gathers her things and walks to the door of the hospital room.
For what it's worth, I love you too, Mom. I always have, even though you've never much deserved it. But it's time for me to move on.
Theo and Winnie return to the chapel. They sit on the pews together. Winnie cries softly, and Theo holds her hand in comfort.
She didn't get the painting. But she loved me. In her own little way. She loved me. But she didn't get the painting. It was all you slaves.
Look at me. Then her love loses its significance. Your mom loved small. So many other people love you. Your dad loves you. Caleb loves you. Our friends love you. I love you. I see you. I love you too.
Winnie blows the candle out.